Pensado's Place is brought to you by...
The ship is in. We got brand new ITL, lots of information for you. You're at that place. It's Pensado's Place.
Hey guys, we got a great show for you today. I can't wait to get going. The ship is in.
It is in. we've been trying to get this ship into port for a while, but we did it.
We did, man. I tell you what, guys, we're going to have so much fun today. This cat is somebody I've admired from afar, and now I get to do it from close. I've actually kind of gotten to know Mike Shipley a little bit recently, and you guys are going to have a blast. He's truly a legend. I hate the word legend. He's somebody that I've ripped off so much, Herb. You've got that contract ready for me to go for commissions and stuff and percentages.
He actually gave us some papers backstage. He just sued you.
Oh,
okay. No, we're really excited about this. Why don't we get some of this stuff out of the way so we can get to it?
You told me you had a lot to do. Let's do it.
All right, so guys, here's what we got. We're obviously coming to you from the Art Institute of California, Los Angeles. Happy to be here in our beautiful HD studio. You know our social media stuff. Get to that, Facebook, Twitter, our YouTube channel. We'll get back to you like we always say, and we do, and we try to do that. Jacob Schneider is in our chat room for our Vintage King folks. We went to a great affair there this weekend, correct?
Man, I had a ball.
Yeah, we saw a lot of our friends. They threw a great thing at the VK
LA. Crystal Algae was there and got to talk with Chris a little bit.
We saw CLA. We saw lots of folks, lots of friends. We saw Stephen Slade. We saw lots of folks.
Stephen.
Cool.
Stephen's a piece of work, isn't he?
Yeah, we're getting ready to have a lunch and talk about some stuff. Love what he does. Cool thing about Vintage King, we got a brand new redesigned website there. They've got new content. User reviews are happening at the space. It's faster. You can create wish lists. You can order easier. So go to Vintage King. They are growing and improving, and we love the relationship we have with them.
I didn't get to ask the stump the guy question.
Well, I haven't gotten to you yet about that.
Okay.
See, you're out of sequence. So it's coming up in a second.
I did it right in rehearsal.
You did.
rehearsed it.
At their new website, you can even catch the latest episode of our show there, so do that. So now do your stump the Vintage King guy question.
Okay. I read somewhere, and we're going to find out if this is true, that Mike Shipley has had special cables constructed made out of an alloy from some kind of foreign planet, or maybe it was gold, I can't remember. But do those really help? Can you actually hear it? And whatever his answer is, we're going to check his ass today because Mike's going to tell us the truth.
All right, so there's
he better be on his game today.
There's the stump the VK question, so make sure you do that. To our avid friends who, we got some good stuff coming up. The Bobby Lombardi, who is just a rock star in the avid universe, is going to join us in a couple weeks, and we're going to drill down deep on some questions and sort of challenge them on some of the
ethos. I had lunch with him, and I learned more in 30 minutes from him about
brilliant
Pro Tools. Well, he wrote the damn thing.
So. Brilliant, brilliant. And so that's going to be exciting. So you'll be able to go to our website and go to our Facebook page, get some questions ready for that. That's going to be good stuff. The contest, our Indaba contest, is going swimmingly. Lots of entrants, lots of happy folks. So this is the last week to enter. It closes next week. Go to IndabaMusic.com/Pensado's Place. Make sure you get that stuff in there. The guys are great. It's Billy Martin's Wicked Knee song, Muffaletta. They're great folks. And you get stuff for this. We always like to get you stuff. So you can win $500. Your mix may be officially released on the album. You'll get an interview on our show. Get in there. Show us what you can do. When you go to that website, you'll be able to that URL, you'll be able to download stems and enter and so on and so forth. So make sure you do that. We want to show you off to folks. And then one last piece of information. This is important stuff for the show. Because of the gift that you've given us, education is a big space for us. And so we've created, we want to sort of garner more information about the education stuff for some discussions we're having, because the discussions we're having, we're trying to do more things for you guys. So go to pensadosplace.tv/education, and you're going to see a submission form that literally asks for four pieces of information. If you're part, we want to garner the education programs that either watch the show or use the show. So if you're a student, teacher, whatever the case may be, it'll ask for your name, your affiliation, pro, student, teacher. the education program that you're part of, universities, colleges, audio programs, workshops, whatever the case may be, and the last thing it'll ask for is the name of that place. So your name, your affiliation, the name of the education program, and the location. And what we're trying to do is garner where the show or the education component hits around the globe so we can pull all that together. Very important for us, and we'll come back and be a benefit for you. So again, pensadosplace.tv/education. Enter it real quickly. You're doing us a big solid, and we'll bring that solid back to you. Another couple things. We're going to AES. We got a couple things we're doing up there. They are on that Saturday. Dave is going to moderate. We're going to be up there, the whole camp, myself, Dave, Will Thompson's coming. Dave's moderating a panel for the Grammys, which is a very cool thing. I think it's Songs That Changed My Life. Elliot Shine. There's a few people on the panel. It's going to be cool. Yeah. It's from 2 to 2:30 in the Moscone Center.
Forward to that.
That's going to be good. And then later on, we're going to partner with the folks at Gobbler for a hangout. It's 6 to 9. It's going to be at the House of Shields right down the street from the Moscone Center. Make sure you do that. The whole Pensado's crew will be in place. Stop by and say hello. And last but not least, a quick shout out to somebody in Oakville, Ontario. Tyler Seidenberg, I got to tell you, your lady, Joriel, is very supportive. She's proud of what you're doing. She wants you to keep going. We're proud of what you're doing. You keep going. Thanks for watching us. And that is your shout out this week. Just somebody wants some support. So let's get to Into the Lair.
That's so sweet.
Let's get to Into the Lair and rock it out. Actually, you know what? Interestingly enough,
what?
We should do a segment on support structures in this business.
You know what? At Vintage King, I met like maybe 7 or 8 people, and 6 of them were introduced to me by their wives or spouses.
Exactly.
It's so cool that...
And you know, and Mike knows, and I know that if you don't have a support system that supports you in this...
It's hard to do this with an angry woman at home.
And your children, and your reps, and your family, other stuff. So we'll get to that.
Your dealers.
Let's go. Definitely your dealers.
Oh, wait a minute. I got stuck in the 80s for a second.
Let's go to Into the Lair, sir.
Hey, guys. I think this one's pretty self-explanatory. It's a bit of an expansion and repurposing of a classic technique, but I think you might find this interesting. And then it's self-explanatory. Will guided me through this, so I know it's good. Last week, Will Thompson and I were talking about, our producer, Will, we're talking about some new ITLs and some new ideas, and I was running a couple of things by Will, and this particular ITL today caught his attention, and so we decided to kind of expand on it and bring it to you. It's not totally new, but it shows the application of principles in a new way, which is something I'd like for you guys to learn, because I think that's where a lot of opportunities are in the mix world, because we are constantly running into problems, and how we solve those problems can determine our value to the world as mixers. So I like to hear, in some mixes, not all mixes, but sometimes I like to hear that little extra octave. And by a little extra octave, I'm talking about 8K, 10K in my vocal. But that frequency range can also be what makes a song sound dated. It can make the song sound harsh. It can be something that you never hear on a pair of laptop speakers. So if you're going to work in that world, you've got to be very careful. It's like working in the 20-30 cycle world. You give up a little bit of headroom when you go down that low. Now in the top end world, you don't have to have a headroom problem. But it can provide some, at loud volumes, it can hurt your ears. So you don't get a lot of purchases from a mix that's hurting somebody's ears. Listening to music should be a non-contact sport. So let's start by doing this. I'm going to show you. I had a shaker part, and I wanted the shaker part to have a lot of top end. But when I added some top end to the vocal, they were competing, so I found I was adding too much top end to the vocal. So I'm thinking, well, why don't I just sidechain the shaker with only the top end from the vocal? Now, I had already split the vocal off, and everything above 10K, excuse me, is on a duplicate track. So let me show you what I got going on. I think it's better to show you than talk about it. Right here is my original track. This is a Dave Huff track I've shown you before, but it's just so perfect for this. Now here's the original vocal without the top end added.
That wheel won't spin itself like a train without a track.
So what I've done is I've made a duplicate track. You can see it's pretty much identical. and then everything below 8K is rolled off. Now, I wanted it to be stereo so that I could put its own reverb on it, and I put a little bit extra chorus harmonizer on just the top end. So my main vocalet is dead center, but the top end is going to kind of surround it, and it's going to create an amplification of just some emotional feelings. We're not trying to get frequency out of the top end. It's the area of the vocal that allows me to feel some of her expressiveness, her pain. I know this sounds a little corny. It sounds a little corny to me when I say it, but it just enhances the feeling that I get from the vocal. So let's check it out by itself.
That wheel won't spin itself.
Okay, that's just the vocal. Now I'm gonna put the high pass filter in.
That wheel won't spin itself like a train without a track. Sometimes fate needs a little help to change the place you're at. That wheel won't spin itself like a train without a track. Sometimes fate needs a little help to change the place you're at. That wheel won't spin itself like a train without.
So we're right around 8K, that's close enough. Now this is what the vitalizer is doing. It's helping me make it stereo because it's originally a mono signal. And then we're doing a little processing, but you could do this without the vitalizer. You could do it with EQ and maybe a chorus, maybe Enigma, maybe a harmonizer with one side 2 or 3 cents sharp, the other side 2 or 3 cents flat. This is what it sounds like with the vitalizer.
That wheel won't spin itself like a train without a track. Sometimes fate needs a little help.
Let's add just a little bit more reverb to this high-end only information.
That wheel won't spin itself like a train without a track.
Okay. Now let me play you just the shaker part and the high-end information so you can get a feel for what I'm doing. I know I'm kind of over-explaining this, but the reason is so if you see the process and some of the thinking, you can apply this to the same situation with a bass, you can apply it with a guitar, whatever you want. Right, I got bus 35 here on my side chain for the compressor, and then let's find bus 35 over here. Let's turn that on.
That wheel won't spin itself like a train without a track. Sometimes fate needs a little help to change the place you're at.
So you notice the high frequency information is controlling the side chain and dipping the volume down very naturally. We've set the release time and the attack time in time, and it just feels like the high-end information comes to the front. Okay, you guys want to hear it all together? Let's check that out.
That wheel won't spin itself like a train without a track. Sometimes fate needs a little help to change the place you're at. That wheel won't spin itself like a train without a track. Sometimes fate needs a little help to change the place you're at.
What you'll notice is when I engage the side chain, it feels like the level of the high-end information gets just perfect, just sits in the track because it doesn't have anything to compete with. So it's you could do this with just straight up automation moves, but there's something kind of organic and natural with letting the compressor do it for you. Normally I'm not that lazy, but in this case it really works. Spend extra time with the attack and release. A technique for that is crank the threshold down a little more than you might need it, and that'll help you set the attack and release because you can hear it exaggerated. Then when you get that timing set right, a la Jack Joseph Puig, then you can put the threshold back where it belongs. As always, experiment, send me some of your ideas. I love reading your ideas. I just got a great email. I'll announce the name of the gentleman that sent it, but he sent me like four or five points. And I really appreciate that when you guys do that. Okay, next week. Mike Shipley, good to see you, my friend. I've been waiting for this moment since the, 1930s or 1940s? Back when you were doing the man, did you ever do wire recording? Have you ever seen one of those, a wire recording?
I've seen them, but no, I haven't done one.
Herb, the old tape recorders were not tape. They were a little piece of wire.
Yeah,
and you record on a wire. I've seen one, but...
Yeah, brilliant.
How do you edit that, like with a pair of wire cutters?
And a soldering iron.
Guys, the reason I'm giddy is, I'm telling you, Mike's just a walking encyclopedia and dictionary of everything that you guys and I love about this profession we call audio, and we're going to try and get right into it and pick his brain. All the records that I mentioned earlier, he didn't do the okay versions. He did the best versions from all these acts. I mean, like, who doesn't like Photograph and all those songs, you know, all the Def Leppard, the best Def Leppards. Let's jump right in on that, Mike. You cool?
Sure. Yeah, of course, yeah.
So, there's so many rumors about those records. Yeah. Of course, you did them with your close friend and fellow Australian, Mutt Lange.
South African.
That's right. He's South yeah. African. I
yeah.
forgot.
Yeah.
How long did those records take? Like, that album took like a year or something, right?
Pyromania took about 11 months. Mm. Major experimentation on that record. And after that, Hysteria, I think it took around about 3 years, but it was not three continuous years. There was a lot of stopping and starting, you know, and...
Photographs on which album?
Pyromania.
Where was the experimentation?
Well, it was with... the experimentation was Mutt wanting to absolutely have the control over how the songs... The experimentation is mostly you go in, record the rhythm tracks...
Sure.
You know, you've did the routining first.
Yeah.
You go in and work the songs out, then you start the recording process.
Right.
His process is, and always has been, that how can I make it so that I can continually change the songs even in the mix?
Ah.
And how can I therefore not have to commit to what the drum pattern's going to be as a basic example from day one? And so on that record, the drums were done last, for example. And that was in the days when, I mean, on Pyromania, it was machine drums.
Right.
It was done with Fairlight, and there was really no way when we started the record to even know how to sync up a Fairlight
exactly.
with a 24 track.
Right.
So it was just figure it out, you know,
just on the fly.
But you're trying. You're not talking about have the ability to change.
Well, you mentioned that song Photograph. Uh-huh. The chorus of that song was changed while we were mixing.
Oh my God! Wow. When you say change, you mean different words, different
different guitar, different parts. You know, so it was a matter of Mutt always wanting to make the song better and figuring out how he could do that the easiest way possible. So even though we're on 24 track and it's the tapes were 11 months old and in the mix there was fans on them, the oxide was peeling off in huge amounts. But literally, he would decide really towards the end. That he had what he wanted, and that's when the drums were done to suit the arrangement of the song. So you weren't stuck with a bass drum part in the chorus that didn't work, whatever it is. And again, that song, I remember the chorus changing in the mix.
So
here I am after 11 months punching in on a 24 track. Are you sure you want to do this? And it's like, just go for it. You know.
You were customizing that suit so it fit perfectly.
And having to figure out how to get these machines to all run together.
Amazing.
Yeah.
Amazing.
I know this was a while back. I can't remember what I did yesterday. That's why I have GI help me out. but I have medical
reasons.
If you can remember, the way that the guitars are so massive on that record, even got a little touch of my buddies, Joaquin and
on which record are we talking about? On
Hysteria. The guitars, they're going to kill me when I say that they have a little bit of a metallic tone, metal genre tone to them. How did you make those guitars fit with the vocals? I mean, it's almost like they sit in a sonic trough or something. because the guitars are loud, they carry the song. Well, those are songs. The melodies are as important as the guitars, and you found a way to make it all work together. Do you remember struggling with that? I'm sure.
Big time. Well, Pyromania was one way of doing guitars, and Hysteria was another way of doing guitars. On Hysteria, it was basically all Tom Scholz Rockman.
Are you serious?
Yeah, I'm serious. Yeah.
I didn't know. It doesn't sound like a rock man.
Well, we went to. Well, it did. It did at one point, and then we spent. I mean, the chain that the guitar sound would go through, how many EQs and how many different ways to modify the sound, because that has a certain sound. Well, there was.
It has that also, compressed sound.
Yeah, very much so. But Tom Scholz actually modified it.
The Rockman. You cheated, in other words.
Yeah. Well, ZZ Top also used the Rockman, and we kind of modified it more towards the distortion that they use, because so you know, when the Rockman would be open with wires hanging out of it to you know, to as we modified it. But yeah, when you get the build up of that, because they were heavily layered. Also, there was a Randall amp used for some of the some of the cleaner stuff, but most all of it was Rockman. So
did you EQ like the classic sentence is you carve a hole for the vocals, or you know did you find yourself actually thinking, let me take out some 600, some 800 from the guitar?
Absolutely. Yes. There was a lot. I mean, those mixes took a long time on Hysteria, because I remember the phone call from Mutt was like, Skip, that's what Skip. This one's only going to take 6 weeks. And it's like, okay, but bring a couple of samples with you, and maybe a bass sample, and maybe some drum samples.
He said 6 weeks.
He said this one's going to be six
it
weeks.
It took a year.
Know? Yeah, it took actually. Yeah, it took about a year to mix that record. Yeah, because actually there were no drums or bass on the multi-track. It was guitars and vocals, and
wow.
You know, yes, we spent a long time figuring out how to get the guitars to work, both effects-wise, depth of field-wise, because they were heavily, heavily layered. So we'd do a mix and spend weeks on it and abandon it. And you'd say, okay, Mike, zero the console, pull all the patch cords out, pretend you haven't heard the song. Let's try a new approach. Mm-hmm. And it's like,
wow.
Okay.
My brain is sitting here thinking. It must have been a pleasure. I know this sounds like a non sequitur, but it actually fits. My brain is sitting here thinking, as an engineer, it must have been an absolute pleasure for you to do Alison Krauss, where you had total control. You could be Mutt Lang when you wanted to, and you could be Mike Shipley. You won a Grammy for Best Engineered Record.
I know, that's crazy.
And congratulations.
So
what a great record to win for.
As I said to them, I hadn't engineered a record in 15 years or something. It's like, are you sure you want me to do this?
So, and then boom.
But you won a Grammy for that.
Yeah.
Man. That's incredible.
Okay.
I don't think people understand what a talent you have in terms of when you hire Mike Shipley to mix, you ought to hire him to do the whole damn thing, because it's part of the process. Mm-hmm. I mean, to hire Mike to mix, of course, he's the best there is.
That was a really good process, and it was great to get into that again, you know, and to kind of to go back into the things I'd been taught at a way younger age. And put them into practice again, you know. Mm-hmm. I mean, that was a fantastic record to be. Number one, how can you mess up with musicians like that?
Right.
The best, the cream of the crop to me. I mean, those guys are just
it
brilliant.
It doesn't get much better.
It really does not.
Yeah,
it does
yeah.
not.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
One of the things on that record that just made me, I guess the only way to say it, Herb, is just I just got jealous.
Mm-hmm.
The vocals have effects on them. And normally, as an engineer, my ear is drawn to the effects, but there were a lot of effects, but I'd find myself, after two words, not hearing any of the effects.
Yeah.
It was genius, man.
Mm-hmm.
The effects didn't go straight through on the vocals. You used them in little sections, right?
Oh, yeah. I mean, they would change from between the chorus and the pre-section and the verse and so forth. I mean, depth of field is everything to me, and making it so that you can't necessarily hear it, but you can perceive it, and it spreads a little bit, but you don't want to hear, especially in music like that, with her voice, you want that to be really focused. But I would change the what the delay was, and whether it had how much feedback was on it, or what the reverb was, and definitely tailor it to it.
Everything was always moving.
Always moving.
Did you use any plugins on that record, or?
Yes, well, some of that record was...
In terms of effects and stuff?
No. I mean, it was mostly
outboard gear
for effects, yeah.
Mm-hmm. What about, like, EQs and compressors? Did you use any?
Well, part of it was mixed on a J at House of Blues in Nashville, which is where we tracked it, uh-huh. And some of it was mixed at my place, kind of in the box. So it was a mixture of both things. But
and you're comfortable in that kind of hybrid space, correct? And
yeah, I like that hybrid space.
Yeah, yeah, because it gives you more control.
As long as I've got the analog gear that I like to use as well, then mm-hmm. I am very happy with it. Yeah, mm. Especially these days. I wouldn't say that a few years ago, right. But now the converters and clocks have got better, and plugins have gotten better, and you know,
this would be a good time to go into my cable thing, because the FM version of the 192. You took a 192, which was, I'm guessing in your opinion, adequate, but then you took it to the next level. You had it highly modified, and then you were using. Is it true you were using gold and silver cables to get in and out?
Yeah. Well, this again, the modification black, again came black, from, black, from black Lion.
Black Lion.
The modification idea came from Mutt, because he tracks up so many tracks of instruments. You can have a 400 track count easily, and you know, he got very sick of the pinched sound of what digital can be. So it was his idea to get Danny McKinney involved, both with the cable thing and with the modifying the converters
and the clock too.
And the clock, absolutely. And when you ask about the mic cable and the power cable thing.
Oh yeah, the cable was for the mic. That's what it was. It wasn't.
It's actually for both.
Oh, it
it's
was.
It's power cables and it's mic cables. And I've, you know, this is a really tough subject to talk about, and it gets to be a very personal opinion. But and the best part, if you really want to get an answer out of this, you should get someone like Danny McKinney on this program, because he can explain it to you in a way, in layman's terms, mm-hmm. that no one else can, that makes total sense. But all I know is that with Alison, for example. She likes a certain kind of microphone. She likes the C800B, I think it is. And Danny had modified, had built a mic cable for us to use, so we were able to AB it. You know, he's very much into this golden silver.
Are we talking
cable.
Like night and day, or have to really strain to hear it, or use
no.
headphones to hear it? It was night and day.
Night and day.
Like $1,000 worth of night and day, or $100 worth of night and day?
$100,000 worth of night and
no
day.
No crap.
To me.
You know, you hear that, GI?
Yes, I do.
I mean, I've read all the forums, and I know everyone's got an opinion, and they all hide behind their monikers, sure. And everyone's got something to say.
That's so true.
And all I know is that, for me, changing the mic cable, and for Alison, and for everybody else, of getting Danny's mic cable, and plugging that into the same microphone and having all of a sudden the top end open into something else that was not there before.
That's a significant difference. Yeah.
A very significant difference.
Absolutely.
Not subtle.
Right, not at all.
Let me ask
major.
You a philosophical question, because I think I know the answer. But I'm guessing that there are some similarities to the way you and I work. And a lot of times when we approach a sound, we don't listen to it for what it is, but what it can be. And
sure.
So when you replace a mic cable with a gold, it's not that you're trying to do anything else, but get it to ultimately realize the perfection of that sound that you heard in your head. Sometimes you can do it by EQing. Sometimes you can do it by compressing around the
problem.
As soon
as you hear the sound, you know what you want it to be.
Exactly.
And as soon as I replace the
and
cable.
So it matched that in your head.
Well, the EQ button came out. Didn't need any EQ.
It was that much.
Yeah.
Wow. That's sense.
Just
that's
did it to do a bit of filtering, you know, filtering out some of the extreme bottom end, and then it was like, whoa. This
wow.
Is
you might have to raise my rate, Herm.
I was just making that note.
And it's a totally, you know, everyone's got an opinion about that, and say, so how can a power that comes in to a socket
make a difference
if you shield it three ways and bring it out?
Right.
Plus it's being rectified into DC and all kinds of things.
Yeah.
I was reading an article, I think it was a Sound on Sound article, which kudos to who wrote that. It was very well done. And you mentioned a concept I had forgotten about the 1-to-3 mic ratio concept.
Right.
Can you describe that? Because I think our audience would really appreciate that, because we were talking about the phase problems, and here's a formula to kind of help eliminate those.
Pretty much so. Well, again, it was because of Alison's record, knowing it was going to be really sparse, I wanted to have as much as I could, a wide, very wide stereo image on all the instruments, because, you know, there's a lot of places where it's just two acoustic guitars.
Exactly.
And with it, I stereo mic'd everything, the mandolin, all the guitars, everything. And the only way to really do it that I found that worked was to do the three in one principle, you know. So, and so I'd have, you know, we'd measure it. Then after measuring it, there's a point where you flop the phase. Mm-hmm. Then you move slightly to find out where the top end is going to, you know, get comfortable. I mean, it's not going to obviously cancel out, but you got it. But I just love that width. I love the I love the stereo image of that. You know, even if you're having it at one and three, if you're having it half center and half
the
right.
The basic tenet is for every inch you are from the source, you can go 3 inches wide. You go 3 inches wide with the mic for every 3 inches you are from the source. Is that what it is? I can't remember.
It's one in three in that every...
I think I said it backwards, didn't
I? Yeah. You've got me confused now.
Me too. G.I., ask somebody to look it up for us on the internet real quick. I think it's either for every 3 inches you are from the source, you're one apart, or for every 1 inch you are from the source.
Now you got me upside down, inside out.
Yeah, I confused myself. Sorry, I should have...
And our audience's careers are now just going in the tubes.
Oh, yeah, but no, they straighten it out. They straighten everything. And then... And part of this quest for perfection, you started working on your own monitors. Is that still an active thing that you're doing?
Yeah, that was another thing that came from Mutt. I mean, you know, we've used every... Speakers become flavor of the month.
Yeah.
You know, then
yeah.
There'll be some new brand of speaker that'll come out, then everyone's got that, and then, you know, Mutt has a warehouse full of speakers, and he just said, Skip, I'm so sick of speakers, get together with Danny and come up with something. I don't want to hear them until you're done. You know, mm-hmm. I don't want to hear them. Just send them to me when you're finished. You know, monitoring's I can't find anything that works for me. Mm-hmm. And again, it was along with Danny who had started the whole process off, and we'd found tweeters from Denmark and, you know, different elements from all over the place. And Danny was the one who really built the system, and he and I were involved in how it sounded. But yes, we came up with a monitoring system which is actually phenomenal. It's a four-way system.
Are they for sale?
No, they're not.
Oh, they're not for sale.
No, I don't really know why.
Like, what about, like,
but they should be.
As a gift to close friends? I mean, is that...
I have to ask Danny about that. There's a lot of man hours in it. And
those initials are DP.
It's just the most... I've never heard anything like it.
Is that right?
It's staggering, actually. Yeah, at low volume, you know, at high volume. It's so detailed and so accurate. Beautiful.
What's your second favorite near-field monitor after those?
I have to say NS10s, because it's one of those things, better the devil that you know. I've used them for however many years. Yeah. I've been through phases. I've got Pro-X that I've used for 15 years, and I'll drag them out sometimes. But I'm most comfortable with NS10s than with these new monitors that we have, you know.
I'm sitting here so enthralled in the answers. I'm forgetting to look at my next questions. One of the things that I think I'm hearing on some of your records is, I hope I'm right, Lord knows I won't be embarrassed, but are you automating the thresholds on some plugins for Oh, thank goodness.
Yeah, okay. Absolutely. Automating the thresholds, yeah, for sure.
And it sounds like I'm hearing more EQ changes from that than I am compression changes. It sounds like, is that your goal?
Well, you're hearing EQ changes too. I mean, it depends which record you're listening to. I mean, it really depends on...
Well, the Alison Krauss record.
There are EQ changes for sure,
okay.
Depending on proximity, you know, whether it's the verse or the chorus. I always do that, which, I don't know, it just seems to work.
Prior to plugins, how did you do it?
Just by malting.
Oh, yeah.
A lot of malts.
A lot of malts, yeah.
You know, there'd be a malt for
even
for certain words, you know,
yeah.
Even for the verse you'd have.
On Christina's first album, I had eight channels of her vocal.
Sure.
It was torture. Not working with Christina, but having eight.
I'm so used to that. I mean, it was torture at the beginning, but again, with Mutt, it was like, you know, with him, it's like, I'm gonna get what he wants. I'm gonna figure it out.
Yeah.
So you'd have a lot of. Channels with different EQ.
Sure,
you know,
sure.
And also you'd be EQing on the fly during the mix, you know.
Wow.
So.
Wow.
I read also somewhere that you use the L2007 a lot. That's one of my favorite plugins too.
It's a great plugin. Yeah.
I like using it for individual instruments rather than, I think it's designed more for like a stereo bus limiter.
Yeah, yeah.
But you prefer to keep the stereo bus somewhat free of compression, right?
Yeah, yes and no. I mean, recently I've been using my favorite thing across the stereo bus these days. Again, it's a requisite audio thing. It's called the LM2 limiter, and it has this feedback limiter circuit into it, which just, whatever Danny has built, I've never heard anything like it across the stereo bus, actually.
You and I have another thing in common. Sometimes we don't have to put anything on the stereo bus because we give it to Brad Blackwood at Euphonics, who's my favorite guy, and he's the best.
He is, because he's, fortunately, you know, I went to him because of the whole level thing. You know, I'd send stuff off to the usual candidates and have to send it to three or four people to see, you know, and it depended on what they'd been working on that day, some heavily compressed rock band and some overly loud band. And Brad was someone I could get a dialogue with and say, let's get the waveforms, let's make this a quieter record, you know, because people can turn it up.
I'd rather not have
that weird brick wall thing that you don't know quite what it is. It's aggravating you sound-wise.
Yeah, it annoys you. It gets on your skin. Yeah.
I agree.
Just a quick aside for the audience. One of the things, and one of the reasons I'm talking about the Alison Krauss record is he won the Grammy for engineering for that, but another reason I'm talking about it is there's no drums in this record. Now, if you want to study what Mike Shipley does, unless you're specifically interested in how he attacks drums, this record is perfect because I can hear all of the nuances of his skill in this record because they're not competing for space with the drums, right, Mike? There's so much space, you can study what he did on, like there's an instrument, it was either the mandolin or the dobro. I swear I'm hearing some kind of chorus on that, which...
Well, you are.
In terms of pure... music of that type, that's heresy, but you snuck it in on me, and it was so good. I couldn't hear that if there were drums.
A lot of stuff was heresy. I mean, using delays was heresy, and so, I mean, I don't know what's heresy. All I know is that they asked me to do that record, and I just went about it, even in terms of mic pre's and miking up, and what just felt right, rather than going by what people think that you're supposed to use or what's available in the studio. And even in terms of mixing, you know, delays on certain instruments, I don't know what
it's
heresy or not.
What you're speaking to is interesting. We were talking beforehand, and you had made mention that it's important to remove cynicism, to not be cynical. Remember we were talking about
that? Yes, absolutely.
Tell our audience what you mean by that.
Well, what I'm in this day and age, there's so much information that you read, and it can be from forums, because there's no mentorship these days. There really isn't. So there aren't the greats you can go to who can demonstrate something. Like, I was so fortunate enough to have, when I was starting off, of the absolute cream of the crop engineers who would show you things, or you'd see them and you'd ask them questions. And everyone's
tell the story. You're in the middle of a Who session and somebody stops just to show you.
At Wessex, Bill Price was the head engineer who built that studio. Having come from Air Studios, he'd built that studio, and it was the most amazing place to me. But I remember, I mean, I just had a big mouth when I was a kid, and I would have to ask questions. And Bill was one of those guys who would, when the band was routining out in the studio and he was getting sounds, he'd say, "Let me show you this. Let me show you what overheads sound like in this configuration." And he'd go, "Okay, guys, you know, keep routining the song. I'm just going to show something for Mike, and I'm going to record a bit of it, and that'd be fine with it." And he'd go out and change the overheads or change the snare mic or the position, because that's the only way you can talk about it till the cows come home.
Absolutely.
But the only way to really hear it is to hear it played back.
Yeah.
And then you can go, "Okay, now I hear what you're talking about." And that was people like that.
Amazing.
What made it for me, because he would go to any lengths
to
demonstrate something.
And
that's the only way to...
Today, right?
No, you don't have that at all, I think, no.
And so the net result is people can develop a cynicism without knowing it, which then affects their ability to be creative. And
I think so. I think it puts a block between them and the music. And you can get cynical about the state of music. You can get cynical about...
That's really true.
The state of sounds. And all of it's true.
Right.
You know, things may be in... Certain perceptions aren't like they used to be.
Right.
But doesn't mean you don't do anything other than try to... You don't dismiss it.
You got to get beyond it.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah.
You got to make it be fun. You got to make it be fun, and you got to put the work into it.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Mike,
absolutely.
When you sit down to start a mix, do you start... You listen a little bit to the rough, and then...
Absolutely,
Do you assemble your own little... pseudo rough, and then you start with the rhythm tracks first, correct?
Yes, I do, to a certain point. I start with the rhythm tracks, yes, but I mean, you know, that changes drastically as soon as you put in guitars. You know, you can spend all day trying to figure out the perfect drum sound and how much ambience you need to use and what the bottom end needs to be, but bring in the guitars and bring in the other instruments and then it changes. So at a certain point, you have to kind of abandon that and then come back to it. Mm-hmm. You know, so
it's like a pendulum that you finally you get it and then the mix done.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't really know even when that point is. It just kind of...
That's what you say all the time.
Oh, I just run out of time.
You don't really... I mean, it used to be a matter of abandoning it. It's been a couple of days. I don't know what else... We had to, you know, again, working on a lot of the Mutt stuff, is because when you work for such a long period of time, the sounds are so ingrained in you that what else do I do with this sound?
Right,
you
know,
so,
yeah.
What's the biggest step up in terms of pleasure and fun in mixing, like, say, the difference when you did, say, Def Leppard to Maroon 5? When you got to the Maroon 5 project, what would you say to yourself, man, I'm so glad I never had to go back and do that again? What part of the process is more fun for you now?
There's no part of it that isn't fun for me now.
That's a great answer.
The most fun is... listening to the intention of what the band has in their rough, and you can make a decision like that of what you want it to
roughs
sound like.
Roughs are clearly better now. Yeah,
roughs are clearly better, but you can also, I mean, to me, it's like, you know, you listen to the song and you go, okay, now I know what I want to do.
Yeah,
and you can dive into it, and as long as you have the tools to be able to, you know, you can hear phase problems, you can hear whatever you can hear that you can fix.
Mm-hmm. Amazing. I mean,
it's all fun, you know.
Yeah, you know, and that's part of removing that cynicism and getting to that
fun part.
You have to make
it fun. You have to find a redeeming feature in everything so you can get
into it.
That's true, isn't it? Absolutely. Yeah. You have to. I mean, you're not going to like every song that you mix. Mm-hmm. You're just not going to. Mm-hmm. But you can always find an element of it that you can attach yourself to so that everything else becomes, you can get into it.
I'm blessed with an ego that once I touch it, it becomes the greatest song ever in my mind.
Exactly. Yeah, right.
Exactly. Can't be great without an ego.
And by the right, way, right.
By the way, it's October, which means it's World Series time. So you got your arm warmed up and ready to...
I'm nervous, Herb.
Huh? I know.
I'm nervous.
You got a big league swinger here. Tee it up, brother.
I tried a couple little shots earlier, and he'd like, home run.
Yeah, the ball hasn't landed yet.
Thanks for the encouragement, Herb. Whose damn side are you on?
I'm on everybody's.
You get a percentage of me, not him, Herb.
I'm Switzerland. Yeah, but I need him to come back as a guest. Tee it up.
Are you ready?
Sure.
Lead vocals.
Lead vocals, like everyone else will say, 1176, but also STC8 and stay level. I love the fatness of the stay level. Love that on vocals.
Herb used to work with Brian McKnight, and the stay level loved Brian.
Loves a lot of singers, actually. It's a phenomenal book.
Yeah.
Rock guitars.
For compression?
Mm-hmm.
I tend not to compress them until I'm mixing them. I just like to get the sound right. I don't compress them when I'm recording.
If you're using a rock, man, they're over-compressed. Just a little snide remark from the host.
But that's a long time ago on one record.
Acoustic guitars.
Acoustic guitars, Pultec EQ for sure, Crane Song, mic pre for definite with the fat button pushed in.
Wow.
Nothing like it in the world. KM54s to me.
I never used the 54s. I always used the 84s. We'll talk about that after the show. Acoustic piano.
Depends on the piano.
Bosendorfer with the extra four keys.
Well, that's what we had at Wessex. We had a 9-foot-6 Bosendorfer that was the most staggering piano. Freddie Mercury was just known as a great piano. I think actually it was 86s that we used on that primarily, in fact.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
The smaller one.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Live strings.
Again, 84s. 54s, you know.
Do you ever find yourself EQing the live strings, or?
No, not so much.
Yeah, we don't.
Don't need to. No.
Okay. It was a trick question. Just checking. overheads.
It depends again on the kit. I like to use 87s. I like to use, you know, like for toms too. I'd prefer to use big condensers rather than dynamics and so forth. Yeah.
I'm gonna dig deep. Give me 1 second. I'm gonna dig deep here. Got to stump you on one. Your favorite piece of gear for under $500?
Mm.
I got him, Herb. I got him. He's thinking.
I'm not sure. I don't think so.
Under $500?
He's thinking.
I don't know how much anything costs anyway. But
let's be nice. Okay, I'll take that as an answer.
Can I have that? So I don't know.
What's under $500. He's operating under candy store rules.
Maybe these days they're Rev 5. I don't know. I mean, I still like.
They're cheap.
There you go.
Okay.
I don't know.
How did you do her?
Remember
who you see every day and who you love and who.
And I'd say it's a grand slam with the bases loaded.
Damn.
They're still
good
around.
Good job, Mike.
It's not that you didn't pitch well. He just has a big bat. So good job to everybody. Why don't we keep that going and get to our man, G.I. Griffin, over in the corner office. G.I., you got some questions for us?
Oh, yeah.
Did anybody tell us about the 3-1 thing? We're right, weren't we?
Yes.
Okay, good.
So we got a lot. The first up is from Marcella Rhodes. Mike, you've worked with many of my favorite bands such as Yes, Rat, Whitesnake, Scorpions, Def Leppard, Van Halen. How was the transition from the way you produced and mixed music from the 70s and 80s and the way that you work on modern music now with the demands of younger audiences?
Great question. It's a whole series, but great question.
That's one question.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking.
There's 10 more of those.
Well, the difference of the old days is that you had to commit. You're working on 24 or 48 tracks.
That's right.
And you had to commit. You had to make a decision about drum sounds.
Great point.
And you had to pretty much get the sound right. Because in those days, there wasn't the ability to have 300 compressors, 300 different brands of EQ.
Right.
You know, there was you committed to a drum sound that took up 8 tracks.
Right.
Because you knew you had to record everything else, and everything else is equally important. These days you can go as far as you want, and I don't think that's a great idea.
I agree.
I'm not real excited about that lack of commitment. I'm a big believer in commitment, and what ends up happening is we do the commitment, and it might not be exactly what the producer wanted if he had committed earlier. So it's a good thing.
Well, if
for
you
them
commit,
to try and,
you've already got. It's a no-brainer. You've got what you've got. You can modify it to a certain point, but it's not like, oh, in the mix, he's now got 60 tracks of guitar, so we can really get something going. It's like, guys, if you're going to make a record, get it down to a certain size, so it's got a character already. I mean,
when you're producing for your own mixing, what level do you commit? Would you bounce 60 guitars down to stereo, or would you make 3 subgroups with
three
the guitars?
3 subgroups, okay. Maybe, yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's a good question.
G.I.
Next one is from Intonation Productions and JJ Boogie. Maroon 5, Misery, that Mike mixed was outstanding. I'd love to know Mike's approach to drums and low end with his multiple channels of parallel compression.
That was done at one of my favorite studios in LA, at Glenwood Place.
Oh, I
love that studio.
Shout out, Kit. Cat.
And great
Kit,
place.
I mean,
and
Kit,
so,
I mean. Did I say Cat? Kit, I'm sorry.
That was just a great record to mix, you know. It was a mutt-produced record, and I just like bottom end. You know, that's one thing. There's a whole octave missing in a lot of records to me in the bottom end. And
G.I. likes bottom end.
And
too.
I know it's going to disappear a lot of it in mastering anyway. I just like to kind of have a nice fat bottom end. Mm-hmm. I don't know what my approach is, other than to get it till it's right. Filter certain things out. You know, carve a space for everything. And I just like to keep it fat, though. You know. So
do you think in terms of the competition between the kick and the bass and have one or the other win the battle, or you just try to think in terms of making them coexist?
Coexist.
Yeah.
And whatever you need to do. And in terms of parallel compression, you know, just as a matter of rote, I usually have 4 or 5 different compressors I can send any element of the drums into, different flavors of compression. And
kind of like what Michael Brauer does.
More than likely. I mean, I usually have TGI compressors, and I have Fairchild, and I have Fatsos, and I have all different stuff that I can send. And transient designers. I love the transient designer on drums. It's a phenomenal
box.
I
use that on everything.
Yeah.
Give us another one, G.I.
Next up is from Mr. Yev Brosson. What is your opinion of console emulation plugins such as Waves NLS and Slate VCC?
I love the Slate VCC, actually. I hate the word console emulation because I don't really think it is, that they have to think of it just as a plug-in.
Yeah.
And it might be the same color as what the SSL is and all that kind of stuff. Mm. But I have to kind of ignore that and just go by what sounds right, because otherwise you paint yourself into a corner.
Yeah.
You think you're using an SSL.
Dave Hill, the couple of times I spoke to him, that's his concept. I don't want to tell you what it's supposed to do. Either like it or don't
Dave
like it.
Dave is a genius.
A genius.
I love Dave.
By the way, Fabrice, the man that works with Stephen Slate, who designs those plugins, is a genius too.
Absolutely genius. Well, I really like the VCC plugin.
Me too.
It's fantastic. But I also love using his Stereo Bus plugin. I experiment a lot with that. And I think that's genius too. I think that Fabrice is fantastic, and the whole Slate.
I can get you an invite to a Stephen Slate party now.
You want to go?
Actually, I've been to a few.
Stephen throws a good party.
Yeah. He does. They're great people.
He's got one coming up, actually. Go ahead, G.I.
This one's from Richie Castaneo on Shania Twain's "Come On Over." How did you get the tracks to sound so separated?
Oh, great question. That's a great record.
By making the tracks sound all separated.
Yeah.
I don't know, but literally that was done up in when Mutt had the studio up in upstate New York. Mm-hmm. It was a beautiful studio with the first J in, which we had unbelievable problems with. But it's just a matter of literally finding out, because the most important song, you know, with Mutt, it's like we have to have this vocal cerebrally loud. It's got to be all about that. And it wasn't about compression, it's
wouldn't
about riding
say,
it.
You know? Say, I don't want to jump in your territory and answer the question, but wouldn't you say that almost all the processes in mixing are not one big thing? It's a series of hundreds and sometimes thousands of very small decisions.
Absolutely.
And very small. So when you ask a question like that, it's hard to answer it because it's never one thing. It's it's more a philosophy of trying to.
It's a philosophy, and it's knowing. It's just knowing. On a very narrow curve, how to pull certain frequencies out very subtly to carve space for everything. And it's down to filtering, it's down to EQing, it's just down to making space.
Mike, when I was self-taught, when you talk about Wessex and Roy Thomas Baker in those days, I just really get jealous and envious. But at the end of the day, wouldn't you say that we actually learned to address this question on another level? A lot of what we do is not because of anything other than that's the way we really want to hear it. And so the process for us is almost subconscious, and it's like driving a straight shift.
Well, it is. It's kind of like driving a car. All of a sudden you get there, but you still we've been doing it for a while.
Yeah.
So it becomes very second nature. So you're multitasking. Uh-huh. I mean, the more fun thing about working analog to me is because you're using both hands, you're pulling something out here and you're doing something over here, and rather than the whole mousing thing, but it's so second nature nowadays, it's almost hard to explain the process.
I liken it to muscle memory. You guys are like athletes, and there's a certain muscle memory you get from repeating certain things.
Yeah, I'm like
an
athlete.
Well, you're not doing the same thing every time. It's a different thing, but it's the same concept.
Yeah, exactly. G.I., give us another one.
This one is from Sound Right Pro. Mike, what's the best lesson you learned in the studio over your historic career to pass along to a young mixer?
That's another
show.
Wow.
The best lesson is to keep everything fresh in your mind and to, I don't know, just that's a really hard question.
Right.
It's really just to put in extra time to learn. You know, I'm still learning.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's to never think that you know everything.
Yeah, don't you find it an advantage to stay
curious?
Because
it's so much fun not to think that you know everything, and to like, how am I going to approach this? And to really not just do it by rote, to really kind of...
I find that staying curious is important. Hungry and wanting knowledge. And wanting
it's listening to the radio all the time.
Yeah,
it's listening to other to music.
Absolutely.
It's listening to music outside of the control room.
Absolutely.
Because you can get you listen to things a certain way in the studio, then you can become,
you have a different way.
It does.
Yeah.
But when you're out going for a drive and you're blasting the music and you're getting into the music for music's sake, it comes across a whole different way.
Yeah.
In some of our phone conversations, one of the things I've noticed about you is when you look at the legends you've worked with, you still get just as excited about the freshness of working with a new band, an up and coming band, a young band.
Oh yeah.
You
To your point, what are you working on that excites you? Anything you're working on that you can talk about that's exciting you?
I'm working on some stuff with Mutt right now, but it just takes a long, it's a long process. So it is very exciting.
Sure. Because I can't wait to hear that stuff when it comes.
That combination is like peanut butter and bananas sandwiches.
give us one more, G.I.
All right, this one's from Alex Kobolski. Mike, do you have any special strategies for mixing in the box and treating your stereo bus?
For mixing in the box, no, my only special strategies are to make it feel to me like I'm not mixing in the box.
Sonically or just physically?
Physically, and the strategy, well, it's an interesting thing about mixing in the box because there's almost too many choices.
Yeah.
There's a whole lot of choices, that's but I'm true. Also my worst enemy because I like to try all the choices and I'll find that I love, for example, the fact that with the UAD, there's so many different flavors which they've done a good job of, and I'll think I might use the Harrison EQ for this thing because I like the bottom end of this.
I do that too.
And I'll go, and there are certain things of URS like the that I love as broad stroke EQs, things like the Motor City EQ, which is one of my favorite for top end.
The old Motown EQ.
The old Motown EQ because of the top end. So my strategy is not to get crazy because you can end up not being able to even make a decision about something. So you got to kind of limit.
Are you saying you can end up not committing?
Yes, you can end up not getting what you want.
Right. Right.
You know, because it's better just to kind of.
We're doing what we say our clients shouldn't do. Can we do one more question, Herb?
Really quickly. You got one more?
This one's for me. I got to know.
Fire away.
For the Pro-Acts, the differences between those or benefits of those over, say, like the NS10s, or basically what do you like about them?
I've always liked the Pro-Acts. As I said, I was turned on to them by a guy called Joe Furler in New York, and I used them when I was doing a Meatloaf record of all things a long, long time ago, and just loved them. I mean, I loved the fact that with NS10s, obviously, you're missing you have that peaky thing, and you're missing a certain amount of bottom end. But I know how, for my sake, I know how to deal with that and make, like with Maroon 5 record, whatever those records are, and, you know, all the Def Leppard stuff, I can judge bottom end really good on NS10s, even though you can't really hear any.
Have you played with the Vintage King Barefoots? Have you played with those yet?
Yes.
Did you like those?
Yes, I did.
Yeah,
a whole lot.
A little expensive. Boy, those are incredible.
Yeah.
This has been a very quick and wonderful hour.
What would happen if I refused to quit?
Oh, we would just cut you off.
Okay. It was worth a try, Mike. I tried.
There's nothing new there.
Mike and I had a plan.
I hope it was okay.
Oh, it was.
Oh, beyond okay.
Beyond wonderful. Thank you from our audience. This has been a great hour. Can we have you back? Was it painful or would you come back?
Oh, totally come back. No, it was great.
Oh, yeah. We'd love to.
Cause flies by.
Yeah, you know? So we've only scratched the surface, and it's so good for us. Listen, it's good for us. We know we've had a good time when we've just had a good time.
Well,
and this was
next time he comes back, we can just go straight to the meat. You know?
Yeah. You may have to be a repeat guest a bunch. So
in fact, we'll name the show after you can host it next week if you want.
Done.
Have a Shipley segment. Let's go to the Shipley, or we'll call it the Skip.
Why does he call you Skip?
Because Mutt has a nickname. Do you want to know why?
Yes.
Because there was a show called Skippy the Bush Kangaroo, an Australian show.
Sure.
And it was a very funny show where you had this kangaroo, like you could almost see the guy's hands, you know, hold it. Because he calls everyone. You know, he's called Mutt. I'm called Skip.
Right.
Everybody.
Why is he called Mutt? Don't know.
He's called Mutt.
Yeah.
Everyone's got a nickname. Everybody. At least one nickname.
Sure.
They're never called their real name at all.
Well, it's part of this thing. Have had Mike Skip Shipley. Skippy Shipley. And it's been absolutely wonderful. Why don't you say goodnight?
I'm just going to repeat once again. Check out the Alison Krauss record. Don't listen to it on Spotify. This record, you need to kind of have full fidelity because you can learn so much. I did. And I spent a lot of time with this record since it came out. And having the clarity available to you to study without the drums is a real plus, a real asset. And then if you want the drums, there's records you can go back and get those with him too. But grab that record because you're going to learn a lot. And send me some questions about it if you want. I'll try and get them to Mike. Either call him on the phone if it's a question that feels pertinent to the show. Thanks for hanging with us. We got to run, and we'll see you next week.